This is Wrestling Personified, Rik Luxury, and you're listening to one of the most popular podcasts out there today on the social media market, Mitch, Please. Stay tuned. Do I? Yeah. And welcome to episode 25 of Mitch, Please. We have hit that quarter of a century mark. I can't believe I've actually gotten more than 25 people to actually sit down and talk with me, guys. Here we are. And thank you to anybody and everybody that has ever given us a click. All right? And I'm just fresh out of the PCW work farm. I've got so much to talk about. As you guys heard right off the bat, I mean, what a kind of a snarmy, maybe a sarcastic intro there by Rik Luxury. A big shout out to him. And a guy that I've been in the ring with many times. I've been on national television with. Knocked down by, not knocked out, but I was definitely knocked down by Rik Luxury on True TV back in 2009. Most daring, young and the reckless. You can look it up on YouTube if you haven't seen it already. I'm pretty sure everybody I know has seen it because I still get talked about. I can talk to about that still to this day. People, it still airs. But what I want to talk about, before we get on with the show here, and of course I have a fantastic show for you, with, of course, the legendary old school Oliver John here still to come. And also, we're going to be breaking it down with the Valentine love line at the end of the show, answering your questions. But back to Rik Luxury, you know, wrestling personified. I tell you what, one hell of a history with this guy. National television, again, True TV, lots of wars in pro championship wrestling. And everybody wants to know, it's like, if you've seen the video, my Twitter blew up. I got 30 plus notifications. My Facebook, I'm not even friends with this Facebook post. I don't even barely have a connection to it, but it's got 40 or 50 likes and 20, 30 comments as I record this, and growing and counting, as old Lucian Delight would say, and counting. And basically, it's a video taken again of Rik Luxury slapping me right in the face, giving me the old Mitch slap, just out of nowhere, as I was at the merch table, you know, selling like I always do. I'm a seller. Yeah, so here's the deal. First time this has ever happened to me. And my goodness, last show, how many ums did I throw out there at the intro? I was very distracted in my intro last time. I'm going to try to keep the ums to a minimum. But here's what happened. It's like first time ever, going back 2 years, I wrestled Christian Sky. At the time he was Jack Flag in Yuba City, and he beat me. The ref counted too fast. You know, he probably had my tights and I was sick and everything else. But, you know, this Jack Flag Christian Sky kid, whatever his name is, he beat me. And a fan, after he beat me, you know, or supposedly, allegedly beat me, pinned me, you know, officially, this fan gave him $10. And that was interesting. That's the first time I'd ever heard of that happening. A fan paying a guy that just won a match because that fan probably didn't like me. Fast forward, apparently there was a fan in the crowd at the Wrestling War Zone, which just took place this past Saturday night in Pittsburgh, California. So I guess a fan offered Rik Luxury a bunch of money to slap me in the face. So I just think that's awesome. I really do. I think that is clearly something that I've never heard happening. And the fact that somebody would dig into their pocket and pay money just to see me get slapped. You know, a guy must be doing my job right, huh? So that's the story on that. And, you know, Rik Luxury, man, I'll tell you what, that guy's a, he's a genius. What can you say? The guy goes out there and he does what he does. And, you know, my win-loss record against Rick's pretty good. I think I've pinned him at least twice. So, I don't know if we'll ever get back in the ring, but it would definitely be something I would be honored to do, because Rik is Rik, man. Everybody knows Rik. And I hope to have him on this show down the line, because we got him for the intro, so now we're going to lock him down for the show. That's how I do it. I wanted to talk about a couple other things, guys. I did WCWF in Yuba City, hosted that show, and that was a lot of fun. Big shout out to John Cooper and Rotten Piles, because, you know, they run a real professional ship over there. The setup and everything about what they're doing, I've always enjoyed it. I've probably worked there 5 or 6 times over the years, and I really enjoy it. And this is my first time being the host. First time coming out to Rap Superstar by Cypress Hill, and the crowd was super, super hot. Really good matches on the show, and just a really great time. So shout out to WCWF. Hey, shout out to the Wrestling Warzone. I got to do commentary for those guys live over the loudspeaker again, and that was a good time. And we'll see what happens with them. I hope they're supposed to lock down an August date, and I'd love to go back there in August and love to go back to WCWF. And of course, Pro Championship Wrestling's coming to you July 15th. I'm going to get more into Pro Championship Wrestling pandemonium after our freaking phenomenal interview here with Old School Oliver John. Let me tell you about Old School Oliver John. I've known the guy since I was 18 years old. My first independent wrestling shows, well documented, it was at the Municipal Auditorium in Oroville. And the main event that night was Scotty Aboot versus Old School Oliver John for the PCW, the Pro Championship Wrestling Heavyweight Championship. Those guys tore it down and made me feel like, wow, this is legit right here. PCW, Oroville, this is legit. And if I could ever be on those guys' level wrestling for that championship, I'll be happy. And I was able to do that. And I never got to wrestle Old School Oliver John. And that's something that I just, man, I wish I could have, because I would have learned so much from him. And I have learned a lot from him just by talking to him and training with him over the years. And he came down to the PCW work farm and for 3.5 hours delivered just one of the greatest seminars I've ever seen and been a part of. And what can you say? I mean, Old School Oliver John is a legend, and I was honored to get him on this show. I went up to him and I said, hey, you know, he's been slammed all day. He did the seminar and NorCal tonight, and you know, watched the whole show, gave everybody feedback, came to the after party, gave everybody more feedback, and I went up to him and said, hey, Ollie, you know, I know you've been slammed all day, and but I just want to let you know I have a podcast if you're ever interested in getting on. And he looked right at me and said, Mitch, please, I thought you'd never ask. And, man, it just made my night. And we proceeded to sit down in my girlfriend's car and have a 42-minute conversation here talking about his career and highlighting all, well, not all, because, man, so many stories and so many experiences. But I think you guys are going to enjoy this. So enough jibber-jabber from me. Let's cut over to Old School Oliver John. Well, it is a post-Pro Championship Wrestling Work Farm Wars. We're out here in Oroville, California, and I'm just so honored to be welcoming to Mitch Please. He is got so many accolades, I don't know where to start. PCW champion, Pro Wrestling Revolution champion, mm-hmm. All-Pro Wrestling champion. Mm-hmm. You had Sheamus' first match.
I did.
And you trained my trainer, Zach Primetime.
Yeah, I did.
You are Old School Oliver John.
That is who I am.
Ollie, how's it going, man?
Mitch, thank you for having me out, man. I've been thinking about you. We finally linked up tonight, and I'd been thinking about you because I get your podcast sent to me, and it's an honor to be a part of it.
Absolute honor to have you here, man. I told you earlier today, or let you know, you know, my first independent wrestling show was Pro Championship Wrestling. Extreme Measures, 2006, yes. At the Oroville Municipal Auditorium. It was the first independent wrestling show I'd ever been to, and I took tickets at the door that night, and the main event was Scotty Boot defending the PCW Championship against Old School Oliver John, and man, that you couldn't have a better main event for that first municipal show, and the municipal goes back many years, and let's go back a couple years. And let's talk about how it all started for you, man. What drew you to professional wrestling?
You know, for me, it was the same old thing as everybody else back in the mid-80s. I was in, like, junior high, and that's when the whole WrestleMania thing was big. Saturday Night's Main Event, Cyndi Lauper, Mr. T, Liberace, Muhammad Ali, and that rock and wrestling connection. And that's when it resonated me at first. And yeah, I was into it. I was hooked. And then by the time I saw my first live shows with WWF coming into town, and I saw the live show, I was like, holy crap, I got it. People already started figuring me out because I could do all the impressions of the wrestlers back then in junior high. They're like, you would be perfect for this. And it kind of planted the seed that once I saw, and I was coming out of that that alleyway, the opposite of how they come in, but you could get that feel of walking in this arena. I'm like, holy crap, this has the everything I love, physicality and entertainment. I was always an entertainer, class clown type of guy. I said, this is totally for me. I gotta do this. And that's how it went. That's where I said, I knew where I was going as an adult. That's what I was gonna do.
And who are, like, some of the standouts? You said Muhammad Ali. Mm-hmm. And I think Muhammad Ali is one of the greatest of all time. He's gave credit to Gorgeous George for his promos. Man, so did he inspire you?
You know, I would say, yeah, I probably didn't realize it then, but later. You know, you're seeing superstar Billy Graham, Dusty Rhodes. Like you said, he knows Gorgeous. But his promos were way better than George's, you know. I think he was a superstar Billy Graham, Dusty Rhodes guy. Whether we know it or not, I guarantee you he stole from them because he was laying those same raps down, and or they stole from him. But either or, he got it. That dude just got how to draw money. He knew how to carry lesser fighters, even though it's not a work per se, like fixed. He knew how to go more rounds than he needed to. That you, when you came and paid to see Muhammad Ali fight, you were going to come see a fight. And he would take lesser fighters and carry them and then cut them down at the end. So, what a worker. Just business, you know what I mean? We can all learn from him.
Talked him into the seats.
Exactly.
And who talked you into the seat, man? Who were some of the maybe pro wrestlers that really...
You know, and it was funny, I was talking to people about this tonight. You know, the first one that resonated with me for whatever reason was Don Morocco. And I saw Don Morocco watching the old championship wrestling before suit turned into superstars. I was like, this guy's great. And then Roddy Piper. And then the one that totally started getting hooked up on is after Orndorff fired Bobby Heenan the first time. And I saw Paul Orndorff and what type of shape he was in. And I was like, oh my God. You know, I had already started lifting weights because some of the BMXers were doing it. And I wanted to be a pro BMXer. That was my first dream as a kid. And some of these guys were starting to get a little swole. And so I got a weight set and I saw Paul Orndorff. And I was like, oh my gosh, this is what I got to do. And he wasn't a super tall guy. I knew I was going to be super tall. So I modeled myself after Paul Orndorff.
I can totally see the comparison, man. The robe and just...
Yeah, so that, there's those influences, the pile driver. You know, that was Orndorff.
Yeah, man. So, what got you started training? Because this was... take me through, like, what year and what got you started and who trained you. I believe it was Paul DeMarco.
Paul DeMarco. So, I was lifting like a maniac because I knew that what I was going to do. I wrestled a freshman in high school and I wasn't very tall and I wasn't that heavy. I was 138 pounds and they always wanted me to lose weight. And I knew that would stunt my growth. And I'm like, well, fuck this. I'm getting out of this shit. In hindsight, being 2020, later on, they wanted me to wrestle 190 or 198, whatever it was. And I probably should have done it because it would have given me a solid foundation. I learned it later after the fact after I started working. But I was powerlifting, and I was at a meet, and I was wearing a Road Warrior shirt, and Paul DeMarco was there. He said, hey, I know those guys. And from there, we talked about him being in the AWA as a Russian with Alexis Smirnoff, and he started talking more about his career, how he worked with Bockwinkel in Georgia and was U.S. heavyweight champion out here for Roy Shire. And I just started learning slowly, and I wore him down till where he would just break down and fully train me. And then we started Pro-Am wrestling in 1994 in Sacramento, and that's when I started getting my ring time in.
And you were 17 years old?
I was probably by that. I met him when I was 17 as a powerlifter. It took me till I was 22 before he'd actually start training me. And we opened the gym.
You guys opened a gym and a promotion together.
The goal was to have a promotion. We never did it. And I think it just was too much for me to bite off at that time. And he was starting to have health problems. So we never got it. I don't think we had the capital to really get it going. And but I had this, you know, we were from 94 to 97 or 8. And so I had all this ring time in. Ring time, but not out working. And I finally had a match. He booked us on an MMA card. And we were the intermission, and we got the biggest pop of the night because we did a mix of, because I was doing Brazilian jiu-jitsu and stuff, and I liked the UWF shoot style that was going on in the 80s and early 90s. And so I took some of that and added that in there. So we kind of suspended, not their disbelief, but earned their respect. And they're like, oh, shit, because they were laughing at us first, you know, pro wrestling bullshit. But we went in and were doing solid stuff that it was physical, solid, that once we started throwing in the pro wrestling bumps, they would buy it. And when I went up to the top rope and threw a drop kick off the top rope, it was the biggest pop of the night. And so, on an MMA card. And, from there I met Bob Shamrock, and we were close. We lost our lease at Pro-Am, so I didn't want to open another place. I was burnt out. I was burnt out with too many students not being as serious as I was, and not having the look. We were going to get a promotion if it's a bunch of dudes that look like teenagers. You had to make yourself, the guys need to make them, and this is the problem now. There need to be some freaking men in there. And there's too many guys that, even if they're men, still look like they're in high school. And they look like they're a Hot Topic. And nobody's going to believe that and be fearful of them. And that's what's missing. The guys need to step up and, you know, you don't have to be the baddest dude in the bunch, but you better look like it.
I think there's a reason why The Rock is like the biggest star in the world right now, is because he presented himself as a total badass dude that you want to have a beer with or you just want to hang out with. And
he's all of the above. You know, there's a dude that's a legitimate football player, a big guy, who's good looking. He's got, you know, now because of it, he's a movie star with charisma. He has everything. There's nothing he has, but if he, you know, looked like, you know, a video gamer, sorry, he could have all the charisma in the world. It ain't going to mean shit because there's not a foundation to back it up. And we need the talent to work on their looks and their kind of background information that they give themselves. You know, it could be totally phony and work to themselves. They need a background information that they can build off of. So there's a foundation that I keep reiterating myself with the same shit. But they got to have something where you can whip someone's ass. That's the bottom line. You can't look like the guy sitting in the seats. And that's got to go. And that's what's hurting the indie wrestling. Why there are no territories building up is they're not, they don't have the look, man. I had the look, and I figured out later on after I was kind of beat up and done, all I had to do is go out there and make people believe that I could beat someone's ass, whether I could in real life or not. They believed it. And shit, if I'd have known that 20 years before, and I could have done it then, because I was so strong back then, it was ridiculous, that I could have totally done that and just made my matches so much easier, less bumps and everything. It didn't matter. And the people had gotten behind me, you know, and then I could have had him in my hands, because once you have him believing enough, then you can manipulate him and do things. So
I got you, man. And you talked about Pro IM. That was where you got your start.
I got my start. And then with Bob Shamrock hooked up, I said, you know, I don't want to be a worker. I'd rather go and be a no holds barred fighter. Cause back then MMA was no holds barred. And Bob was starting up a team up here. They kind of had a falling out. Ken was in San Diego going with the Lion's Den and working in WWE to finance that, so these guys could still fight. And, so I started working in Stockton, Lodi to be a no holds barred fighter, and had a fight down in L.A. and won my fight with a knee bar and was moving up the line, went to UFC, met the matchmaker and the promoter at the time. So we were going to groom me to get in a UFC, and I ended up having a detached retina. So that totally squashed it, put me on hold, because I didn't know if I was going to do anything physical anymore, because I was really wigged out about it and nervous. And I had the surgery done to my eye to shore up all the weak spots to go back into pro wrestling. Bob had mended fences with Ken. Ken needed a pro wrestling trainer because he was training for Pride and needed someone to run the pro wrestling. So I moved down to San Diego and ran his pro wrestling school.
Let me bring it back just for a minute, Oliver, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
You talked about doing MMA. Now, were you Bobby Lashley in it? Were you doing MMA and pro wrestling at the same time?
No, I was done. I didn't want to do pro wrestling. I figured that pro wrestling, I could take what I learned from pro wrestling. I knew my natural talent in terms of cutting promos and my look that, you know, I didn't have to worry. I was more nervous about being booked improperly. And I was probably more worried about it and didn't have the confidence in myself really at the time. Then I thought, well, if I go to MMA, all I got to do is train hard and win. And I can build up my persona, get out of MMA, and go to... Because my dream wasn't WWF anymore, it was Japan. And I just wanted to go work in Japan. And I figured with that background, I could easily go and work in Japan 6 months out of the year, make good money, and be comfortable. And that was my game plan.
So Japan was your game plan.
Mm-hmm.
And at what point was that? And then at what point did you go to Japan?
So after... things were kind of going downhill for Ken at WWE. He had some injuries. He lost his Pride contract. And so he had to really downsize and put things on hold for a while. I came back to Sacramento and was bummed out. I'm like, ah, shit, you know, what am I going to do? And just came up here, worked, and still want to get back in the business at a certain point. And I met up with one of my students again, worked on one of his shows to help him out in San Diego. And on the way back, I think Aaron Aguilera ended up working in WWE, got developmental. And so they needed somebody to kind of fill in on the classes. Adam Pearce wasn't making them as much, and Frankie Kazarian wasn't doing the Saturday class. So Rick Bassman needed somebody for Saturdays. So I would go work the show, and on the way back to SAC, go hit the show. Friday night was the San Diego show. Teach for 4 hours in... wherever the hell the school was for UPW. And then I would go home. And through that, I just got good feedback from everybody. I think, you know, Miz was coming out to the class and he was like impressed with the classes. Word was getting out the classes were kind of at a different level. I was able to figure out.
I'm sorry.
Miz, yeah.
Miz, okay.
Miz was coming by.
What was Miz like, man? I think he's amazing because he's gone like 11 years in WWE without even being injured. Like the only time he's out is when he's doing a movie.
Right.
What was he like back then?
He was super cool. Yeah, I didn't have many interactions. Came to a couple of my classes, and he was funny because he would refer to himself as the Miz. You know, like Big Show came out to kind of, you know, work with them, and he introduced himself as the Miz, and like, you know, Big Show was kind of like shitting on it. Like, what? You know, the guy was just a character. But he, you know, as far as I knew him at the level, he was a nice guy. He was a cool guy.
Cool, man. And then you were telling a story today at the seminar. The infamous PCW work farm, you know,
yep,
here in Orville. And you were talking about working with Balls Mahoney in Japan. And
yeah, that was in Portugal.
Oh, I'm sorry. In Portugal. Okay. How many years total did you, before you stopped wrestling full time?
So I started training and I started learning when I was 17 or 18, like in 90, 91. But by the time I was really, you know, getting in the ring, whatnot, 94, started really picking up in, you know, really, the span was on and off. And then and in 04, I was like, fuck it, I'm just going to do this. I'm going for it. You know, because there was times I just burned out. I didn't like it. But I thought, you know what? This is what I really wanted to do. I will regret it if I don't pursue it later on in life. So in 04, I started really upping my game and going down. That's where I made the connection with Bassman. And Bassman called and said, hey, you know, Aguilera's gone. I need somebody to fill in for him with Alcatraz to be the Hardcore Incorporated. Do you want to go to Japan? And I said, sure. You know, it was on my bucket list. Hell yeah, I want to go. And my sixth match in pro wrestling live match, I had shitloads of training. I was a trainer. But tons of hours in the ring, but not live. You know, there wasn't much going on. And it was not easy to get booked because everyone wanted to be the next Roy Shire. Everybody. So the promotion were hard to get in unless you made that connection. So I went over there, worked Shinya Hashimoto and another guy, sixth match, man. And we worked two shots and the matches went well. Thought we'd keep going back, but for whatever reason, I missed my booking because I think both times, even when I went back again with Hustle And both times, WWE released a bunch of people. So I was to go back, but got replaced. Got a good rating. It's like, shit, finally I'm going to go steady. That was my whole goal. Had I just gone in and had a couple year run, I'd have been fine. I would have left wrestling. Because I was a little bit older. But that didn't happen for me. But I did get a couple shots out there and get to do a couple tours. It was fun. I should have probably pursued it more, though, and been more aggressive. Marketing myself. I let too many people market for me. And that was hindsight being 2020. Especially today, it'd be so much easier to market yourself. You guys got to just push yourselves and market yourself and make your own brand and identity and just run it yourself.
Great advice right there. And what do you think was like your most memorable experience in Japan?
Oh, well, shit. You know, there's a couple of, you know, really, because with the hustle thing, it was really super gimmicky. But these guys were all shoot guys. And so Nobuyuki Takada was the leader of it, Team Monster. It was incredibly over there, selling so much merchandise. And he was the leader. And Yoji Anjo was another shoot worker that I liked. And they were just doing tongue-in-cheek shit. Because really, Pride was trying to shit on pro wrestling. And they were trying to kind of nudge New Japan out of business. But I got to work with these guys that I idolized, and I was on their team, and that was a cool thing to be able to be a part of that and get to be, you know, picked and selected to do that, and getting to work Hashimoto, because, shit, that dude's a legend over there. I mean, I had goosebumps standing in the ring when he came in with that persona. I was like, holy crap. In the back, it was like, you know, that movie Ready to Rumble, where he's chain smoking back there, and it's just kind of a regular dude out of shape. But when he got in that ring, it's like the dude was 7 foot tall and, you know, 400 pounds of muscle, you know, just how he carried himself. It was just what a worker, you know?
Yeah, and so a lot of that was 2004, you said?
That was 04, 05. So probably about 05 by the time I went over there.
And then 04, 05 comes in 06, which, as we started, like that's when I met you. And, man, I just thought you just were the ultimate professional, man. It's like you looked great on a flyer. Like, you were amazing in the ring, the reaction, the way you interacted with the crowd, your body looked great, your work was so solid, man. I'm just a huge fan. I gotta be honest. And how was the NorCal wrestling scene, say 05, 06?
I was really nervous getting in. I was reluctant getting into it. Actually, the change, I realized, okay, I'm getting these shots in Japan and stuff. I need to, and I'm, you know, on the radar to do WWE, and I'm like, I need more ring time. I don't have a gym anymore. I don't have that time, that luxury. So I talked to a couple of my old students, and that got me in touch with Schizo. And so I got to PCW at about the same time as, I think, at the beginning, I was going to Japan for Hustle. It's when I met Zach and went out there and started training with them. And that's when we clicked, and I was able to get in there, and Skits was kind of pulling back, so he wanted somebody to be able to come in, and he'd been talking it up for a long time. If you get Ollie here, it's going to be, you guys will get what I'm saying, and we're going to be able to expand on it. So that's how it was. Once we started locking horns and just putting in that time, hand-to-hand, just feeling your way through the stuff, that's when we started brainstorming, coming up with better ways of doing things.
Yeah, so Schizo, man. I never got a chance to meet Schizo. What? He's been talked about a couple times on the show. What are your feelings towards Schizo? And did you guys wrestle each other a lot?
Yeah. He was one of my students, and the guy had it. It is, he said, he was rough around the edges. That's how he termed himself. And so, you know, he kind of had some, just deems, I think, probably, and I don't know the particulars on it, but, you know, I think he had some struggles, you know, that were hard for him. And he was somewhat forthright without giving me too much detail. I didn't need to go into it. We would ride, and I would take him out to the work farm, and we would train. And I spent a lot of one-on-one time at the last year or two with Pro IM, and just getting time with him and improving him. And another guy, Smasher, Carl Weber. And these guys had talent, and really, Mark had such talent. He had the body together and not had the rough around edges, you know, things that he had to deal with, that guy would have been, the guy was a worker. He was a talent. He was a really super intelligent guy. He was a good dude. We got along, Mark and I got along really well. And it was great that he hooked me up with Zach, because we were able to get ring time in, and he had to step out of the picture. And we just kept going with it and coming up with better ways of doing doing things, like I said before. It's coming up with the same shit that you're always doing, but doing it a better way than you ever done it before, and better than anybody else in the area was doing it. So at that point, it opened up where I started talking to Iron and started working with Donovan and Mike, and the goal was to get me over to Noah as part of Chaos, and then everything kind of went to shit on that at the end. There's been a few times in my career where I was right there, you know, with UFC, with Noah, with a few where just shit just didn't work out, you know. It was frustrating, but I got to work with people and really validate and getting a lot of respect from my peers who I admired in the business. So
I'm gonna bring it back one more time here. Yeah. However, John, man, you talked about that style that you and Zach would do, and he calls it realistic wrestling, man. Make it look as real as you possibly can and make the people believe everything you're doing. And it was a really hot time in pro championship wrestling. It was you and Schizo and Zach Primetime Reeb and Brian Cage and AJ Kirsch and Scotty Aboot, man. And you guys were wrestling every week. And what are your memories of those guys?
Well, shit, you know, getting to work with Scotty was easy, man. We had some, like, you saw that match where it was so easy with Scott. And it was
quite a few of those matches. Yeah. You guys wrestled quite a few times. Yeah. Great matches.
Just easy. And some better than others, but we never had a bad match. There was no such thing as a bad match. With Zach and myself, there's never such thing as a bad match. It would just flow. It was super easy. Super easy.
Do you remember 2 out of 3 falls in the Municipal Auditorium for the PCW Championship, you and Primetime, back in, it was like, November 06?
Yeah.
Dude, it's on our YouTube channel.
Yeah, I've been able to watch it, and I'm like...
It's one of my favorite matches.
It just flowed, man. Everything just flowed. And, you know, and with Zach, teaching Zach, you know, it'd be frustrating for me because I would teach him, and he would get it more than I would get it. You know, he would take it and just be able to get more out of it than I was able to get out of it. And so, I'd be like, son of a bitch, you know? I'd be like, goddamn, you know? But it's that's what you want. You want the people you're working with to be better than you. And because... it makes you better. It's a ping pong match, and each one of you, it's rallying back and forth. You keep upping each other, so it's best for everybody.
You mentioned Pro Wrestling Iron, and everybody knows there's a big war between all pro wrestling Pro Wrestling Iron. What was your experience during that time and with both companies?
Well, I was an Iron guy, and that's where I met Tom Caster, and I met Big Ugly and Vinny, and that got me to Portland. So then that got me the Pacific Northwest Championship, and so that was great to be able to meet Porkchop Cash, the Grappler, Rip Oliver, all these guys that I admired, and for them to give me that vote of confidence to get the strap. And I don't feel I had good matches there. There were certain places where I just wouldn't feel in my element. I wasn't having PCW style matches up there. I was nervous for whatever stupid reason, and I never felt like I represented who I was there when I was there.
Well, no one can be perfect all the time, man. Yeah. We all have off days.
Yeah.
Even old school Oliver John sometimes, maybe. I don't know. I've never seen one.
That was the same with APW when I first went there. I just wasn't clicking. Now, by no means is it bad, because in comparison, I still was able to pull something up, but I would get a lot more gratuitous taking the big bumps and over-chopping people, you know, just to kind of... You know, it's my kind of form of cheap heat. You know, I knew I could get cheap pops and get people into it, but I wasn't using my art form to the level that I could until I got comfortable being there. And so, because Zach and Tom and John LaRocca are the ones that convinced me to go there. I pulled back for a long time because I'm like, I've heard so much shit about it and attitude and politics. I don't want to do it. But I started doing it, and it was good for me. It led on to other things, and they built up my confidence in terms of marketing myself a little bit more and getting a cauliflower and making more connections, networking.
I think everyone knows the famous old school Oliver John back chop.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Disrespecting. Woo! But I stole Paul DeMarco's front chop, and I did it on the back because I would just... Because, and people say it's disrespectful. I don't see it, because you're going on their upper back. I mean, certain spots will sting too much, but you have this wide surface area, and most guys are working out and have their lats built up. It's an easy chop. It's open, and it makes a tremendous, noise, and it gets people into it. And then later, I got smarter. I always knew, I figured I was pretty stiff and stingy, that I would figure out ways that they could give me my receipt. And it was always awesome. It would just get the people back into it, tit for tat thing.
And you mentioned all pro wrestling, and of course your former all pro wrestling champion, universal heavyweight champion.
Two or three times, I forgot how many times it was.
So, Jim Wars, Hayward, yeah. California, probably some Bakersfield Dome shows.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Scotty and I had another one in Bakersfield, yes. That was good. That clicked, and we clicked. It was easy, and I ended up getting ringworm from him. Thanks, Scott. Oh, man. Yeah, I'm done with it, but I'm not sure, but it wasn't. It spread all over me, damn it.
Scotty Ringworm a Boot.
That's his name.
Man, Oliver, I think that we might have to go two parts for this because you have such a historic career. I'm trying to turn this light on and check our time here. Very unsuccessfully. But we'll touch on a few other things here, man. You've had an incredible day. You've been here probably since 11 a.m.
Yeah.
And 3.5 hour seminar. Mm-hmm. And
supposed to be two, but I can't. That's not enough, man. There's too much information. I'd had 20-something years in this game, and I it's not enough. You got it. I get on a roll. I can't be stopped.
Man, and you also had some experience in Ring of Honor. If we could touch on that.
Yeah, that was Donovan Morgan got me booked on that, and you know I had to go with Ryan Drago, you know, and he had a bum knees. He had just come back from surgery, so I was nervous. Like, oh shit, you know, it's his first match back. We went in there and we mapped out our match. We were the opener in the dark match, and it clicked, man. It went well, and got a please come back chant. And the next match, the guy's laid an egg and got a please go home chant. And so Sapolsky wanted me to go out. He couldn't get me out to Ring of Honor yet, but he was going to go FIP, and I'd keep going out to Florida and then build up. And that was another career mistake on my part. I was burning out on wrestling, and I was figured I was going to go for CHP instead and be a highway patrolman, go get a normal guy Joe job, because I was 34 years old at the time. And stupid, I should have gone to Florida and been doing those, because that would have gotten me in that realm and built up my indie name. Which would have led to the Japan shit. I've made numerous mistakes in my career, self-inflicted.
Well, I think one of the greatest moments I ever experienced as a fan was like 2009, living in Chico, California with mm-hmm. a bunch of dude roommates.
Right.
And we got the TV out in the front room, and I'm watching ECW on Sci-Fi or whatever channel it was on.
Yeah.
I can't remember. I think it was Sci-Fi. Might have been USA. But I was watching it, and it was like live on Tuesday nights,
mm-hmm.
and all of a sudden, they're hyping up this big Irish guy, you know,
right.
with the red hair and the red gimmick beard and the cross, and Sheamus comes out, but in the ring is a guy that's very familiar, and I had no idea this was happening. You wrestled Sheamus in his first ever
yep.
WWE,
yep.
ECW,
yep.
his debut, man.
Yep.
Can you take me through that day and what led up to that?
That day,
how it went?
A lot of it was building up, because I was getting a lot of, I won Future Legend Award. I had a 5-minute standing ovation working Goshi Ozaki at Cauliflower. I was on the radar big time, because all my time and work was starting to all come together in my look, my promos. And I did a promo at Cauliflower for a seminar, and Pat Patterson heard me and said, give me your card. I got to get you in touch with Laurinaitis. Laurinaitis called me, and I kept in touch, but didn't hear back. And I finally said, well, there must not be interest in me. A year later goes by, I come back to Cauliflower, and everybody's shaking hands with him, and he's all, you don't need to introduce me. I know you. Why are you not a super big star right now? I said, what do you mean? He's all, didn't you get a hold of John? I said, yeah. But he just quit calling me. He's all, you're not there because of you. So, as I said, some of my self-inflicted situations where I didn't get proactive and market myself and knock on that door and not take no for an answer, I blew that one. But he kept me in touch again. And Harley, at a match with Goshi, took a liking because he was the Noah feeder. And so they were bringing me out there. And I was working on their, they'd have that camp every year. And were really pushing for me. And I was getting on the main show and getting a lot of push, hopefully get me to know Harley really was behind me and got me booked again. And that's what led to that, doing those three shots there and getting to work with Sheamus. And as it turned out, Pat showed up. The age of tour match was Dean Malenko, who lived with Bob and Ken Shamrock. Everything was falling into place, and people, I'd done these before where nobody even talks to you, they kind of ignore you. And this one, people knew who I was. And they were coming, and introducing themselves to me, these stars, you know. They had heard good things about me. And so then we had, you know, everyone was trying out to do who was going to be the enhancement talent, and they just were flipping and flopping and all over the damn place. And I went in there and was calm, cool, and collected. And I was the guy selected, and Steamboat, and Gold Dust, Dustin Reynolds, you know. Dean Malenko worked out the match. And then also, Laurinaitis wanted... And, you know, Pat took me to Laurinaitis and said, you got to see this guy work. So Brian Danielson was there trying to get a tryout. And so we worked for the agents and Laurinaitis together 5 or 10 minutes on the fly. And they're all, have you guys ever worked before? We only worked once. And the match clicked. And everything was going perfect for me. It was just a trip. And then, you know, Sheamus, I had the match. And, you know, for him, that match needed to go well. Otherwise, that could have gone a bad, you know, he could have gone back to Florida. Everything clicked. It was, when I came out, the audience knew who I was. And there were already pockets of people already, I'm like, are you kidding me? This is going to be easy. Scott Armstrong was the referee, so it was like super easy. And he was like, made it so easy for me. It was super cool. And I came back. I was so thankful. And the buzz was coming, you know, guys were coming back. Hey, you made him. You know, they were just being super cool about it. And I'm like, oh my God. And like Jericho and Edge were cutting promos and doing their multiple takes. And he broke it and came over. Oliver John said, yeah, he's all, I just want to say congratulations. So I'm like, oh shit. And so had a meeting with John. He's like, hey, you know, how much did you make? You own her house, blah, blah, blah. You know, look, he's all, you know, I was like, hey, do you need me bigger? He's all, look, I hired Boogeyman at 44 years old. I hired Rey Mysterio at 5'5". Your size and all this and your age doesn't matter. You have it. I have to figure out what to do with it. And it was to the point where he's saying, you know, you're too good for developmental. I can only pay you this much. I want to see what we can do with you. And I didn't know if it was a test to see if I'd be egotistical or what, but I just let him do. And there was a thing I kept calling, didn't hear. Obviously, they didn't come up with something for me to do. But I needed to be more persistent. My mom got really ill at the time, had kidney failure, actually. Her kidneys were starting to fail. And so FCW started sending me stuff. I'm like, at that point, I couldn't go make, at that time, what guys were making, like $500, $750 a week. There's no way I could do it. And so I was like, I let it go. Probably was a mistake. Probably shouldn't have done that. But I was 37, 38 years old, and I was pretty beat up. So, you know, I don't know. I don't know if I had to do it differently or not now. But it was tremendous to have my peers recognize me. And then I had that second life through Gabe Ramirez, working with Blue Demon and Santo. And I got to go do main events in Mexico City, work in Puerto Rico. All my bucket list bullet points were touched, but I did want to make my living for a short run somewhat, and I never did. That evaded me in pro wrestling, but I did a hell of a lot for some guy in Sacramento who had a sick parent, and it wasn't just me living in my car, because I would have done anything, but I had some other obligations that always kind of kept me grounded in Sacramento. But I didn't let that dissuade me to see where I could take it, and I got so close so many times, and I still got to do some cool ass shit, and it was my second income. You know, I made an income off of it, so you know, no regrets.
I think it's an absolute travesty that you haven't got a WWE contract yet. I think you could train at NXT. I think you should have got a contract 10 years ago, you know. But I just wanted to say that you've lived such a great, amazing life. It sounds like, man, so many ups and downs and just wild turns, and like,
and so many students have done better than and are doing bigger things, and it's awesome to see people that I've been able to work with take what we came up with, because it would be a, you know, how I teach is not one way. I try to get the feedback, and we create together, and because I want them to be able to create on their own, that they go on to these world stages and are doing things and making their living on the indie scene. It's pretty amazing, and it's just it feels good to see these guys do it.
You've impacted so many people to this day, no doubt, and in the next years and years and years to come, especially with your seminar today, and can't thank you enough for that. And man, just, I gotta get you back on the show, man, because we're getting a little, you know, close on time here, and I feel you have so much many more stories to tell, and I just wanted to ask you, Ian, maybe in closing here, because like I said, you had a long day, man, and I much appreciate you coming here. There you go. What do you think has been maybe your top two, top three experiences, like your favorite match, your favorite moment in the crazy wrestling business?
You know, there are moments for different reasons. That Ring of Honor, to go in Ring of Honor and work my style, which and back then, you know, it was a very spot-oriented style, and I went and worked my style. And to get over like that, and get that, because they were very, you know, it's a heckling fan base, and to earn their respect and go out there, that was awesome. The Hashimoto was amazing, to get to work with a legend. And then, you know, my Blue Demon stuff, and working with Io Del Santo down there, and getting to go on that stage, and come back and see I'm drawing a bigger house each time I'm going. There were a lot of validation, and sitting down with Laurinaitis and getting that sort of feedback from people that I have respected, you know, in positions like Harley Race, and seeing his, because he would give me the correspondence when he was telling them, if you don't hire this guy, you guys are stupid. And it just was validation from people I admired, and it just, I was blessed with a bunch of cool moments. And dude, I feel like I lived to my potential. No, I really needed to go and work full time somewhere to take myself to the level that I think I could have done. But it didn't happen for me, but other people have been able to take what my experiences and then build upon it for themselves. That's awesome. And, you know, and going forward, I'm going to do more of these seminars and try to help these young guys out, because I know what it's like to have that dream. And, you know, normal people kind of shit on this dream. You know, they think it's something that, you know, an 11-year-old by the time they're 12 could get over it. But it's not the case. I mean, if you have, like Roddy Piper called, if you have the sickness, it doesn't go away, and you gotta see it through to wherever, how far your potential is. And if I can help some other people get where I wanted to go, I'm gonna help them.
That's what's up right there. I just got one more question for you. I promise. What is your favorite thing about pro wrestling? What about pro wrestling is the most, like, impressive thing that draws you to it? Like, what is it about pro wrestling that just makes it so special to you?
It's really the process, you know, being as a worker. Because, you know, when Paul DeMarco started changing, as I teach you this stuff, you're not going to be a mark anymore. You won't be a fan. The same way. You will look at it differently. You'll see through all of it. And it's true. I don't get caught up into it and lost in it the same. But I appreciate what these guys are intending to do, how they're moving. It's very technical how I look at it. And I look at it, you know, from a third person point of view, like I'm up in the crow's nest watching it. And so that's the process. When you're going in there and you're trying to tell your story and you're trying to figure out what's going to click with that particular crowd that night, being that I'm an improv guy, I believe you should call it in the ring. And when you figure it out, what's going to be the theme of the match that you're going to roll off of for the rest of, until you work into your finish, and then it culminates and crescendos just as you wanted. That's what it's all about for me. And when I see that with other guys' matches, but feeling it on my own, it's that interplay and interfacing with the people's emotions and being able to manipulate their emotions at will when you're really rocking. And I use that term, rocking and rolling. When it's rocking and rolling in there and you really can't do any wrong, there's no better feeling. There's no better feeling in the world.
Man, it's deep right there. Talk about rocking and rolling. Oliver John, old school Oliver John. What's rocking and rolling nowadays for you?
These days, what I've taken, you know, what was I going to do? You know, and basically, you know, when you're in pro wrestling, you're in the sales business. You're selling yourself. You're selling to the people, this, that, and the other. So it's like, what am I going to do? And I'd done some loan. You know, when I met Zakich, I was a loan officer at the time till the market crashed. So I always kind of knew I'd go back to something like that once I was done wrestling. Because, so I went back into real estate. And it's, you know, for me, and it's a 7-day-a-week job, you know, which was easy because that's how wrestling was for me. It was 24/7. It's all I thought about. So I, you know, take my personality and the way I cut these promos and resonate with people and apply it to real estate and helping people get buy or sell homes. And, you know, the American dream, you know, not dusty roads this time, but, you know, home ownership. That's what I've devoted myself to. And that's what my passion is now. And I'm living it, breathing it, eating it, sleeping it 24/7. And have a voracious appetite learning more about it all the time. And it's like wrestling. You never you never master it. You can become an expert, but you never are 100%. There's always something more to learn. Every transaction is unique. And it's very similar to pro wrestling. It's a trip that you'd think that, and you wouldn't think that going into it, but that's what I do now.
Oh, I believe it, man. I can understand you probably have some serious drive. If it's anything like how you are with wrestling, man, you're probably just, like you said, living it, breathing it 7 days a week, just going after it all the way. And
that's the way. Passion. You gotta have passion. If you, whatever you're doing, you don't have passion, you need to figure out something else and find your passion. Everybody who's listening to this, and I know most of us are probably wrestling fans or workers, and so you know your passion, but there will come a time where you need to think about what your next passion was. And for a while when I was done with wrestling, I kind of was in purgatory. I didn't know what to do with myself, because from 12 years old on, it's all I thought about.
Me too.
And once I stopped in 2013, I was like, oh shit. And that was really, it really messed me. I mean, life was a rebound for me. It was almost like, you know, breaking with an old girlfriend and being on the rebound. I didn't know what to do with myself. And, you know, I finally found it. And it's the real estate business and the real estate industry. And there's so many different avenues that way, you know, similar to different styles of work that you can work. And you just, as workers, as you're in this and you're going on, yeah, you want your dream, but this will not go forever. Your body will wear out. You have to find your other passion that you're going to, whatever it is, because that's what makes you, that's what keeps us alive, is passion. Find your passion.
Love it, man. And I'll tell you this, make another promise here on Mitch Please, man. Like, yes. If I ever buy a house, I am buying a house from you, because I've seen some of your videos and stuff, and you're on Facebook promoting yourself. Yep. And where can the people find you on social media?
My social media, you just look up Oliver Steinwant or Ollie Steinwant on Facebook. It's my personal page, not a realtor page, but it's mostly real estate stuff with a little personal stuff with my family. And LinkedIn, and then just hit me up. I'll throw my number out there, 916-802-1694. That is the number you need to call when you need to buy or sell your home, or you know someone who needs to buy or sell their home. Hit me up. If I'm out of your area, it's not a problem. I'm part of RE/MAX. We are the largest company in the world. Nobody sells more real estate than RE/MAX, with RE/MAX Blue Line in Brentwood, but I can refer you to a great agent in your area who will take care of you.
Hold on, man. I got my pen and paper right now. Can you repeat that number for me real quick?
The number. One more time for the folks at home, 916-802-1694. Do not hesitate to reach out to me. And heck, if it's even wrestling related, you can talk to me about that too. My brain is here to be picked.
Man, true class, true professional, old school Oliver John. Thank you very much.
No, thank you, Mitch. I appreciate it. We'll do it again.
Thank you.
Much love to old school Oliver John. And right now, it is time for the Valentine Love Line. What happened here was, I got on Facebook, I got on Twitter, and I asked you to ask me some questions, relationship questions, anything you want. Dr. Mitch is here. It's Valentine's Day every day when you're Mitch Valentine. So without any further ado, let's get to the first question. Miss Alma Crutchfield, she says, hey Mitch Valentine, love doctor. Does looking sexy help when you having sex? Or is ugly good from the door better because you're going to get ugly doing sex? Well, Miss Alma, who am I to give you advice, number one? Number two, I don't even understand your damn question, girl. But I'll answer it the best I can here. I think you should look good if you're getting ready to not have sex. I like to call it bapping. I take a girl to bed bapping beyond. So I say look good. Because the better you look, the more things I want to do to you. You know what I'm saying? Alright, then we got Stephen Lovett Sr. This guy clearly needs some counseling, because his question is, what are the best vegan-friendly ways to masturbate? Well, Steven, I'm going to quote my best bud, GDD, and I'm just going to tell you, put some peanut butter on it. All right, Mike Shoup comes in. What's it like being in a long-lasting relationship, he says. He asks. Almost sarcastically, Shoup, I hear you. I've been in a couple relationships. But what is a relationship? That's the real question. B-Hump. Brandon Humphrey comes on here with a couple questions, some good questions we're going to close it out with here. He says, the first time, do you go missionary with eye contact? Or do you go doggy with some choking and hair pulling? I say both. Then B-Hump says, if the river is red, do you take the dirt road instead? My answer to that, young man, is absolutely. One more here from B-Hump. If she takes me back to her place, and I get her off good, is it okay to raid the fridge? Good God Almighty, raiding the fridge. What do you consider raiding? That would be my question. That girl should be cooking for ya. I mean, if I take a girl back to my place, I'm gonna cook for her. Well, I'm gonna at least order some food. Take care of that. Take care of that little tummy rumbling. Take care of the rumbling. And let's get it on. Thank you to everybody that submitted their questions for the first ever Valentine Love Line. Oh yeah, good times as always here on Mitch Please. And I just want to talk a little bit about Pro Championship Wrestling Pandemonium, guys. If you were at Work Farm Wars on June 10th, you heard my major announcement regarding Pandemonium. And my major announcement simply was... Oh yeah, AJ Kirsch, back in Pro Championship Wrestling. You don't want to miss that one, guys. He's coming back to say bye. It's one night only. It seems like AJ Kirsch is wrapping up his wrestling career, and he's coming home to where it all started for him to say bye to all the great Pro Championship Wrestling fans and all the great Pro Championship Wrestling players. If I can call us that. And I'm really, really, really looking forward to it. And also, one more time. The Bad Boy, Boyce LeGrand, defending the PCW Championship against the Nightmare Sin. These guys have been going to war for damn near a year. Something's got to give on July 15th. And you got a 2 out of 3 falls match for the vacant PCW Inter-California Championship. JJ King, Grizzly Cal, Jack, the two big behemoths, locking horns once again. Rik Luxury and Will Roberts, Colt 45, the PCW Tag Team Champions are putting their belts on the line against... the Lucha Horseman, and that is the King Fat Boy, Papaesco and the Russian roughneck Fedorov going down for the tag team championships. Are we going to have new champions, or will Colt 45 continue their dominating reign? And also, the Pretty Little Psycho Kimmy, one-on-one with Samara. Samara's making her PCW debut. It's going to be a fantastic women's match. I'm a big fan of Samara. I met her about over 2 years ago, WrestleMania weekend. Sweetheart of a young lady, works her ass off, and she's making her PCW debut on July 15th. Also, we've got Royce Isaacs versus Funny Bone. All right, we got the finals of the PCW Junior Heavyweight Championship Tournament. Christian Sky, Aaron Sky, one-on-one. Winner walks out as the first ever Golden State Junior Heavyweight Champion. And we have Zach Primetime Reeb versus Mike Showtime Shoup in a Oroville street fight. All right, so it's going to be a fantastic night. VIP tickets are only $15. General admission's only $10. It's a summer special deal going on. You're not going to find prices like this to any other PCW Municipal Auditorium event. Come on out. Enjoy Pandemonium. You guys, you can't do anything else but enjoy it. It's going to be a fantastic show. And, of course, yours truly is going to be the host of the whole damn thing. So you're going to be entertained. You're going to have a good time. Hit us up, Pro Championship Wrestle on Facebook. Hit me up personally, Mitch Valentine. All right? You can find me at the Team Valentine page, at the Got Mitch marketing page. You can find me doing things over at Pro Championship Entertainment, okay? And we've been laying low a little bit, Pro Championship Entertainment, but we were able to get involved with the House Cats this last Friday night at Almendra Winery. They rocked the house, filled the house, and then rocked it again, okay? It was a great show. I'm so proud of Robin Valentine, so proud of Bill Teague, so proud of the House Cats, how far they've come. It's absolutely amazing. And I'm so glad to have Pro Championship Entertainment on board with that. You can find, of course, PCE since 2015 on Twitter. You can find me on Twitter, Snapchat, and Instagram at HeartbreakerMV. And, of course, the Mitch Please Podcast, Facebook.com/MitchPleasePodcast. And make sure you subscribe to youtube.com/TheMitchValentine. All right, the plugs are done. The show is over. Pandemonium, July 15th. Mitch Please, episode 26, coming at ya. Maybe I'll put another one out in July, or maybe I'll make you wait till August. I don't know. You tell me what you want. And thank you to Old School Oliver John for coming on the show. Make sure you subscribe to his YouTube channel, Oliver John, because we're ending the show with a freaking amazing promo that he did a few years back. And you can listen to it here on the show, but then I encourage you to go watch it and see the visualization of what he did. It's just one of the many great things that he's done. So we're going to kick it on over to that. You've been listening to Mitch Please, and thank you.
Tick, tock, tick, tock, tick, tock. Demon. Blue demon. You just heard the sound of the sand going down the hourglass. The hours ticking. The seconds ticking. Till we meet again. Watsonville, July 30th. You and me. Steel cage. Why am I in the mask, demon? I'm painting a picture for you, demon. I'm showing you what's going to happen to you. You think I'm going to tear your mask with my hands? Oh, no. I'm going to tear it with a 15-foot high steel cage fence. I'm not only going to tear your mask, I'm going to tear the flesh on your skull. Demon, I'm also gonna tear that Pro Wrestling Revolution heavyweight title from your waist. We've already had two steel cage matches. and they were bloodbaths. But this time, it's going to be your bloodbath, demon. The third time's a charm. And Oliver John takes back what's rightfully his. That Pro Wrestling Revolution Heavyweight Championship. And for you, demon, it's lights out. Tick, tock, tick, tock.